Big crowd here today. So fall module is all about science of movement. We've broken this down into basically an introductory PowerPoint presentation, a PowerPoint presentation on movement of vehicles, movement of people, and then movement of things and objects. So week number one is going to be dedicated to just kind of introducing the topics of movement and a little bit of just the basic science behind it. So we'll open with just kind of a question of what is movement, what is motion? Very basic terms here. Movement is an act of changing physical location or position. And motion is basically just that act of doing it. What up, girl?
Hey.
Hi. Within that, there are four basic types of motion. Okay, so we'll have to take a look at this because these all should be moving. So I will make sure that these are all moving by the time that we are in class. But our four basic types are rotary, so turning in a circle like wheels, hula hoops, washing machines. Reciprocating, moving back and forth in a straight line. An example of that would be cutting with a saw. Linear is moving in a straight line. An example would be a hockey puck gliding along ice. And then oscillating is swinging from side to side, which would be like a pendulum on a clock. Now, in terms of these examples that I have here in, you know, what should be moving, of course, these are going to exhibit a handful of different types of motion. So, for example, if we have golfers all hitting a ball into the hole, the ball itself will be rotating, but the overall motion is going to be moving along in a straight line. For the laws of motion, this is all theorized by Isaac Newton. Sorry. And the three laws of motion are that every object in a state of uniform motion tends to remain in that state of motion unless an external force is applied to it. Simple terms, an object at rest tends to stay at rest, an object in motion tends to stay in motion, unless if it's resting, something pushes it, or if it's as it's moving, it hits something or friction slows it down. Number two, the relationship between an object's mass, which is m, its acceleration a, and the applied force is, the force is equal to mass times acceleration. Acceleration and force are vectors. In this law, direction of the force vector is the same as the direction of the acceleration vector. Basically saying that things are moving along with each other. And then for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. So just as gravity is pulling us down, we are pushing on the floor to bring us back up. All right, so then how do things move? If an object at rest tends to stay at rest, how does that motion actually happen? And that comes down to force. So as the first law of motion states, objects are going to sit still unless they have a force that acts upon them. Similarly, objects are going to keep moving unless a force like friction slows them down. So a classic example of this is going to be taking a look over, say, a roller coaster. So you're going to have a physical force like a chain that's going to bring that roller coaster up. You're going to have the gravity force that's going to be able to take it from that potential energy to the kinetic energy to allow for that motion to keep going. So applying a force can transition a stationary object to a moving object to stop a moving object in its tracks. Kinetic energy is going to be the energy that an object possesses due to its motion. The work is needed to accelerate or move an object to from rest or from one velocity to its intended velocity. The other type of energy then being the potential energy. It's all about the object's stored energy, what it has that it's not currently using. An object in relation to another object or to a zero position. So us in relation to the drop down on the ground. So again, kind of that peak of that roller coaster. All right, once again, the way that these all came up, I will make sure that these are fixed by the time we are getting them. But wanted to go over the idea of force diagrams. They're also called free body diagrams, and they help us to understand all of the forces at play around an object. So again, if we have this idea of an object at rest tends to stay at rest, as well as the idea of the third law of motion, these forces are going to cancel out, right? So we have these equal and opposite reactions. So if we are pushing a box along on a rough surface, we're going to have friction going in the opposite direction. And that's what we can really depict with these free body diagrams, is we can show that we have these equal and opposite reactions, and that unless we overcome the force in the opposite direction, we are going to stay stationary. If we can simple machines are how the pyramids and the Colosseum and how other ancient monuments were constructed. So our six simple machines are the lever, the wheel and axle, the pulley, the incline, the wedge, and the screw. So for levers. Levers consist of a beam or a rigid rod that have a pivot or a fixed hinge, which we would call a fulcrum. Within all of our simple machines, we have what is called a mechanical advantage. So basically, how these simple machines are able to help us out to make this movement and help make this motion easier on us. So for example, with a lever, the ratio between the amount of force you get and the amount of force that you put in can be broken down by the work is related to the force and the distance. So we'll see that in a second as we'll have some pictures of these levers. If you increase the distance, the amount of force that you need is going to get smaller. So think about a type of lever would be, say, a door. If you were to push on that door at the hinge, you're going to have to really push it to get it moving. Whereas if you push it all the way at the end, you can push it with just a finger and it's going to move back and forth. Fun fact, humans have used levers for at least the past 200,000 years. Ancient Egyptians used levers to move and lift obelisks weighing more than 100 tons. And then we have a quote here at the bottom from Archimedes, "Give me a place to stand and I shall move the earth with it," which is to say, if you give me a place to stand, I'll be able to get a lever and I can physically move the weight of the earth, so long as I'm far enough away. Our levers can be broken down into three different classes. We have class one, class two, and class three. Class one is kind of our typical example, so we have the fulcrum in the middle, and then we have our effort and our load. An example of this would, of course, be something like a seesaw, right? You exert force on one side, which would either push the other person up unless they're heavy enough to bring it back down. Class two has the fulcrum all the way on one side, and then the effort and the load. An example of this one would be something like, say, tweezers. And then class three, just has the effort and the load switched. An example of that would be like a wheelbarrow. Leading us then into wheel and axle. Wheel is attached to a smaller axle, which would basically be a smaller cylinder. The two parts rotate together and they will transfer force from one part to another. So if you exert a force on the wheel, it's going to transfer that force into the axle, which, for example, can help to create at, say, a well, the force needed to lift a bucket up with water. The power that we put into turning the wheel is equal to the amount of power the axle turns out. And the hinges and bearings are often used to support the axle, just making it so it's structurally sound. For the pulley is a type of wheel and axle. We kind of saw that idea with this picture here, that is essentially a pulley around that axle there. With the wheel and axle, the drive force is the force that is applied to the wheel, and the drive force comes from the rope, the belt, the chain, whatever is attached to that wheel. And it's going to support the movement and change the direction of a taut cable or belt, which basically just means tight, or transfer power between the shaft and the cable. There are types of pulleys. We have a fixed pulley, which is probably something that we would be more familiar with. It's when you have it attached to, say, the roof or the ceiling, and we are able to attach a weight to one end, and on the other end, we can pull. So if you think about, you know, if you've ever seen a movie where they're going and they're moving, say, a stage curtain, or if they're on the stage and they're having a Peter Pan fly, that's going to be a type of fixed pulley. You then have a movable pulley, where the one end of the cable, the rope, the chain is attached to the ceiling. The pulley is more so on the ground, which makes the force that you're using move up. And then a compound pulley, which combines all of those, the fixed and the movable pulley, with the motion that you are showing. As mentioned, we have the mechanical advantage, which here I have shortened to MA. Basically, the way that the pulley works is it helps to divide the amount of force that's needed in order to complete a job. So here we see with the fixed pulley, if we have 10 newtons, which is a measurement of force, pulling down with our weight. With a fixed pulley, we need 10 newtons of force to move it. With a movable pulley, given that we have 10 newtons of weight, we only need 5 newtons. We can cut that in half. And then similarly, if we have the compound pulley, given that the fixed pulley was equal, the movable pulley was put into 2, we can again only use half of the force that we would otherwise need to lift the object. With pulleys, we only have to have half as much. Inclined plane is basically a fancy way to say a ramp, where one end of the plane is at a higher vertical distance than the other end. So why would the ramp require less force than lifting straight up? Well, that's because work is equal to force times distance. So through this inclined plane, we're able to transfer the amount of distance that we're actually taking this object. The mechanical advantage of the inclined plane is going to depend on the size of the slope, so how steep is that incline. So think about if you're trying to jump directly up on some stairs versus going up with a longer distance to cover that same height. It's going to depend how steep that slope is. So in this case, the mechanical advantage is the force from the weight versus the force exerted on the object. For our high school girls, they'll recognize this more so from their physics classes. It's a type of free body diagram where we are not only including that downward force, but we're able to get it on that angle as well, given that we are on a slope. Which then leads us into our wedge. A wedge is a portable inclined plane, typically used to separate two objects to lift and hold, or to hold an object in place, such as a doorstop. The mechanical advantage for the wedge is all about the ratio of the length to the slope to the width. So example, a short wedge, a wide angle versus a long wedge, or a narrow angle. We are able with wedges to either have it as just, say, the blue